Arriving a child of God.
Thank you for gathering together with us to get in the Word of God. This is the day the Lord has made, and we are genuinely and sincerely glad in it, rejoicing in it, because God is good and He's faithful. Thank you for taking the time to make sure that you have placed your spiritual life a priority by getting yourself prepared to fellowship in the Word of God. I know you love the Word of God. As I often say, you keep coming to the table to eat, and anytime people love something, they keep coming back. And we're coming back because the Word of God is life and health to all our flesh. And God watch over His Word to perform it. Even the angels hearken at the Word of God. So we're going to pray, and we're going to go right into the Word that we have to share in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you today for this wonderful day that you've given us. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your steadfast love and how you just faithfully watch over us, Father. We just give you all the praise and all the glory. We declare that yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, that you reign, you rule and reign in heaven and earth, and you are the Lord Most High. We just praise you, Father, because you are the God of power. You are the God of wisdom. You are the God of peace. You are the God of revelation knowledge. And so we thank you now in the name of Jesus. As we set our heart to hear what the Holy Spirit is speaking to the church, Father, we are ready with our faith. We are ready to receive the word of God. We are ready to put faith in that word, and we are ready to act on that word in the name of Jesus. Thank you for your strength, and we give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we are talking from the thought, the bowing of the knees. And in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14 and 15, the Apostle Paul wrote, "For this reason I bow my knees to the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named." We also looked at Jeremiah 33 and 3, where it's talking about prayer. He said, "Call to me and I will answer you, and I will tell you or show you great and mighty things which you do not know." So we see that there is a place in prayer where we rise above that level of just praying for our basic needs and praying about matters that's happening in the earth. And again, we are supposed to pray about those things, because the Bible teaches us that in everything through prayer, we are to make our requests known unto God. And when you're in a relationship with the Lord, you don't just pick things you bring to him. You just talk to him. You just communicate with him. You just interact with him. You fellowship with him. Prayer is because you are born again. Prayer is because you have a relationship with the Lord. Prayer is because you have found out in his word how he has established this divine order in order to get his will done in the earth. And prayer is the spiritual weapon that we use in order to do so. We came up with a definition for the bowing of the knees. We said it's a sincere posture and a prioritizing of prayer that encompasses God's desires and eternal purposes for his children and for creation in the earth. I'm telling you, God is up to something. God is moving. God is carrying out a work. God is doing great and mighty things in the earth. And God has given us the privilege to join in with what he is doing through the avenue or the vehicle of prayer. As we go into our lesson today, I want you to take a moment and consider the courage and the commitment that was present in the lives and witness of the early church believers. We find that prayer was the catalyst in mobilizing the church into the harvest fields of the world. Now, however, their prayers were motivated by a movement that was much bigger than themselves and more boundless than they could have ever imagined. This movement and boundlessness is not a man-made agenda, but the agenda of God and the agent in which he would work through in order to make it a reality. Yes, we hear a lot of statements now about different movements and things, even in the world, in the body of Christ, same thing. And sometimes those are man-made agendas. But I believe if we just stick with the word of God, we'll find out that the greatest movement, the greatest movement that's on the face of the earth, is not what we choose to do, it's what God is already doing. And what we do through our prayers, we join in with God's heart, God's purpose, God's plan, God's will that he's carrying forth in the earth. Yes, sometimes when we have our own movement, it's so that we can be great. We can sound like we some kind of organization with some kind of leader or leaders that's these militant men and women, and we're, you know, no, the movement has already been established. The movement has already been given to the church. And it is God's agenda And it is through his agent that he causes this movement to take forth in the spreading of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Acts chapter 1, in verse 6 through 8, listen to this. The Bible says, then they gathered around him. This is Jesus and his disciples, and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates or seasons the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost ends of the earth. You see, these disciples were thinking or expecting something that was not in their sphere of control. And Jesus wisely informs them that it was not necessary for them to be concerned about times and seasons of God's divine order and plan to bring about the consummation of the age. Yes. In other words, Jesus was not rebuking them or reproving them. He was giving them insight to let them know that you need to be focusing on something else. And then in the meantime, he says, the church should be about the Father's business. That's basically what he was telling them. You know, basically what he said, when I'm going to come and I'm going to restore and during the consummation of the age, when he brings all this stuff to a head and everything, and he comes back and you know, restore the church and his plan for Israel, all that's under God's authority. All that's under God's divine timing. That's not really our business in the sense of just waiting on that. We need to be about the Father business. And that business begins with the empowering power of the Holy Spirit. Then this empowering power will bring a courage and a commitment to on the inside of believers that's going to impact the world with the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is at this spiritual junction of faith and faithfulness that prayer becomes the spiritual weapon that leads the church into the world with the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. And sometimes we do not see prayer as a spiritual weapon. For some people, prayer is basically a method for them to get God to do what they want him to do. And they're not about being who God wants them to be. They just want God to do what they want him to do. And so sometimes prayers are just need-centered. Well, you know, the Bible tells us if we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all these things are going to be added. I believe if we just make the kingdom of God a priority in our lives, we prioritize the things of God, stop making excuses, stop being slothful, stop being, you know, lazy and passive relative to the things of God, but being diligent and faithful, that God has assured us that he's going to provide the things that we need in life. The Bible tells us that my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. What do? When we honor God in our giving, we honor God in serving and those things. What God does? God is faithful. Yes, he reward the righteous. And he reward those who are serving him and honoring him with their resources in the earth. Well, I want to look in the book of Acts. I want to look in the early church, and I want us to get a witness of how they use the spiritual weapon of prayer in order to get this now move with God's movement. Yes, yes, they moved in agreement with the movement of God. They didn't create one themselves. You know, they tapped in where God was working. They tapped in where God was already carrying out his kingdom. Purposes, and through prayer they connected with the heart of God. Well, the first thing I think we need to learn about the spiritual weapon of prayer is this. The spiritual weapon of prayer is to be a daily practice of the life of the church and reaching the world with the message of Jesus Christ. If you turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2 verse number 40 there. In Acts chapter 2, verse 40 through 43, it reads like this. And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received the word, his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayer. Oh, glory to God. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Prayer provided the local fellowship the ability to carry out the will of God in taking his word to the world. Notice, it was the word of God concerning Jesus and his mission in the world that caught and changed the heart of those people. If you look at back at verse number 22, the Bible say Peter was preaching the word. Yes, he was preaching the word of God. In verse 22, he said this, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to do you to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know. Him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands, have crucified and put to death, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held by it." Come over to verse number 32. The Bible reads like this. This Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now see and hear. And he goes on to say, "For David did not ascend into heaven, but he says himself, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool.' Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." Now, when they heard this, what was the this? The word of God. When they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" They're ready to change. They're ready to follow Christ. They're ready to confess their sins. They're ready to turn away from their lifestyle of living after the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. They're ready to turn away from the love of the world and walk in the love for God. Then Peter said to them, first thing Peter said, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call." We are living in a time in which the church is no longer believing and building infrastructures that places the message and mission of Jesus above all else. And the result is we are having more church attendees, but fewer church converts. There's a difference. Church attendees are people who are present for personal preferences and pleasures. And that's what happened. When the church become a entity in the earth to focus on being an attractional church, that is, how can we attract people? They will do whatever it takes to appeal to the natural senses, to the carnality, to the flesh of people. And people come in and they become what? Church attendees. They come because this is what they prefer and this is what they find pleasure in. Nothing about what? carrying the message of Christ into the world. Nothing about what? Praying and interceding that the word of God may have free course and transform a community for the glory of God. It's what? It's bringing people in, accommodating people, giving them what they like. Get this, getting the young people in so they can have what? Fun and be with their friends. What about the movement, the agenda of God? The agent, the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not here to accommodate our flesh. The power is here so that the church can be mobilized into the world with the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, so what we have? The message that we preach draws attendees. But when we preach the message of Christ, when we preach the mission of Jesus, it brings converts. A convert is different than a church attendee. A convert is a person who experienced godly change in character and conduct and communicate that change into a fallen world. That's a convert. You know, in Luke chapter 3 and 7 through 9, when John the Baptist came preaching, he was coming out of that wilderness and he wasn't watering down the message. He wasn't trying to accommodate the crowd. He wasn't trying to be something that, you know, could draw attention to himself or cause people to be attracted to him. Oh, man, he lived a very different lifestyle for a purpose, because it was his message that he wanted people to be drawn by. And so in Luke chapter 3, verse 7 through 9, I'm going to read it from the Message Bible, because the Message Bible just makes it so plain and simple and make it so relatable. It reads like this. When crowds of people came out for baptism, because it was the popular thing to do, John exploded, "Broad of snakes, what do you think you are doing slithering down here to the river? Do you think a little water on your snake skins is going to deflect God's judgment? It's your life that must change, not your skin. And don't think you can pull rank by claiming Abraham as father. Being a child of Abraham is neither here nor there. Children of Abraham are a dime a dozen. God can make children from stones if he wants. What counts is your life. It is green and blossoming, because if it's dead wood, it goes on the fire." What's that? Conversion, change, turning around, reflecting Christ in character and conduct, true repentance, not just church attendees, but converts in the church with changed lives. Peter, when he began to talk to Jesus about, and I'm paraphrasing, his level of commitment and what he's willing to do, you got to watch how people talk. You got to look at how they walk, not how they talk. So Peter telling the Lord how he will die for him and all this. And, you know, Jesus being very compassionate and loving toward Peter, simply said to him in Luke chapter 22, verse 31 and 32. And the Lord said, "Simon, Simon, indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren." Listen to how Jesus is real with Peter, because Jesus knew Peter was giving a lot of lip service, but the test was going to prove truly where his faith was, and that faith was going to waver. He was going to get off course. Listen, when you're truly converted and you get off course, you know what you're going to do? You're going to get back on course. You're not going to be off course years and years. You're going to get back on course immediately. Why? Because there's true change that has taken place in your life. So listen to what happened in Luke 22, 16 and 62. The Bible says, "But Peter said, man, I do not know what you are talking about. And immediately while he was still speaking, a rooster crowed, the Lord turned and looked at Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had told him, before a rooster crows today, you will deny me three times, and he went out and wept bitterly. And he went out and wept bitterly. Why did he weep? Because of conviction. Yes, he realized that he had what? He had allowed fear. He had allowed a lack of faith that caused him to get off course with his commitment to Jesus. And why, when he was doing it, he looked up and noticed he was making eye contact with Jesus. Have you ever had that to happen? You was talking about somebody or something, they just popped up right in your face. You just felt what? You just felt, we call it busted. Well, Jesus didn't want Peter to feel busted. He didn't want Peter to feel broken. He wanted Peter to feel what? The degree of repentance that was necessary so he could get back on course. And how many know he got back on course with Jesus? Because if we go on over in the scriptures in John 21, 17, when we find Peter hooking up with Jesus again, Jesus said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. What's that? That's a changed life. You see, changed lives comes as a result of a praying church that makes the word of God the highest authority and communication in the world. It is through the spiritual weapon of prayer that the church witness is not how many people we have in attendance. It's not how many baptisms we have performed. It's not how many ministries we have in our church, but how many converts have come to Christ and are communicating their faith in their context and in their communities. That's transformation. That's a changed life. That's a changed life. And so often in the church, because of egos of men and women and you know, status of want to be popular and great in this world and in the eyes of people, we have a tendency to stroke our own egos by attendees and baptisms and ministries. Where are the converts? Where are the lives that have been empowered by the Holy Ghost that's going away from the church, that's going out of the fellowship once they've been equipped, once they've been filled with the knowledge of God's word and transforming their contexts, transforming their communities? Why? With the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. And a lot of time when people come to church, they're not thinking about gaining knowledge to go out and communicate it into the world. They get puffed up. They want to, you know, everybody want to be a preacher. Everybody, oh, the Lord called me, you know. They just want a platform in a building, you know. Or they want a position on their job, you know. They're not leaders. They're not in leadership, but they find out, I can come to the church and be a leader and get this. Don't have to qualify. Don't have to qualify. No, that's not the purpose of the church. I want us to grab this now, because the early church is the model for the present day church. All right, let's go on. The spiritual weapon of prayer provides the boldness necessary in order to present the gospel in a hostile environment. Look at Acts chapter 4, verse number 13. The Bible says this, and now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus. And seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, what shall we do with these men? For indeed, that a notable miracle has been done through them is evident to all who dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But so that it spreads no further among the people, let us severely threaten them that from now on they speak to no man in his name. Come down to verse 23. It reads, and being let go, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. So when they heard that, they raised their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, you are God who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of your servant David have said, why did the nations rage and the people plot vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For truly, against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together to do whatever your hand and your purpose determined before to be done. Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. The world was hostile to reign in Jesus' day on earth and also in the time of the early church. And it remains the same and will continue to be. However, the God of this world is no match to the God of heaven and earth. Yes, the God who watches over his word to perform it. Now, I want you to grab something here. Because they prayed for boldness. Yes, this boldness that the disciples displayed before the world was simply this: the confidence in which they communicated the message of Jesus and his authority and power to do the miraculous. That's what verse 13 is communicating. Sometimes people, you know, they don't want to go and prepare to be in leadership, to teach the gospel, to preach the gospel. And they'll use this verse. They'll use this verse to be lazy. And, you know, because some people think preaching is not, you know, having the knowledge to teach the word. They think it's being able to perform, to get up and sing and, you know, to be able to shout and scream. And so sometimes people say, well, you know, you look at verse 13, these disciples, they were uneducated, they were untrained. You got to understand, that was the opinion of the world toward them. That was how people looked at them. But they were well knowledgeable of the word of God. Yes, they were filled with the knowledge. They had been walking with Jesus. That means what Jesus had taught them, what Jesus knew, he had transferred it to them. That means that what they saw Jesus did, they were doing. Yes. But what it was that caught their attention was the confidence that and the commitment that they had to the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's boldness. Boldness is when you're not just preaching to be heard. You're not preaching to be seen. You're not preaching to be impressive. You're preaching with authority and power so that what? Even demons recognize the power in your preaching. Yes. They know when there's power. They know when you have authority in the name of Jesus, because get this now, they are afraid of that word, that two-edged sword that's coming out of your mouth. They know you got faith in that word. Hallelujah, glory to God. They know you're not going around trying to mimic or be an echo or try to be like somebody else. They know you've been spending time with Jesus. You've been spending time in the word, and you've got a revelation that God, who did what he did then, he's doing it now through the church. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You see, sometimes people equate boldness with their church tradition and practice when it comes to prayer. For example, if you go into a Presbyterian church or you see a Christian that's in a Presbyterian type denomination, you know, they may just have conversational prayer. They may just talk to God. They're not loud. They're not screaming. They don't think they got to have a mic in front of them. No. But if you go into a Baptist church, you may find someone, you know, who think that in order to pray, I got to rap it. I got to rhyme it. You know, I got to get down there and do and be repetitious and, you know, get down at the front of the church and have prayer service and you know, the deacons going through that process and you know, saying the same prayer over and over every Sunday. You know, no, I'm not condemning. I'm just saying this is what happens. And sometimes people think that's the way prayer is supposed to be. And people will tell you, you know, they hear Deke pray. Oh, man, that Deke can pray. What they'll listen to? Sound, rap. And then you go into the Pentecostal church. They think, oh, man, when you pray, you got to scream. You got to jump. You got to be loud. You got to run. You got, you know, you got to speak in tongues. If you don't do that, you're not praying. I'm just saying, sometimes we equate prayer with our traditional practice. And some people get so programmed with that stuff, it's like automatic pilot. They can't get out of it, you know? But when you pray from the heart, when you are praying because you're spending time in the Word of God, first of all, you know what you're going to pray? You're going to pray the Word. You're going to pray in agreement with the Word. You're going to pray like the authority of the Word. You're going to pray with the confidence that you have based on the Word of God. Not your own power, not your own performance, but the Word of God. You see, what is it that determines the results that we get in prayer? See, that's the bottom line, the results. And this is what determines the results that we get in prayer. Genuine faith in God's ability and His Word. That is what determines the authority, the results we get in prayer. You're genuine. Your faith is genuine. You know the Word. And you have what? You have faith, confidence in God's authority, God's ability, and what He said in His Word. This boldness they prayed for was to open their mouth with the message of Christ in the face of obstacles and opposition. We see that in verse 29. They said, now, Lord, look on their threats. In other words, we're not going to get down on their level. We're not going to get out there contending and have church meetings with them. We're not going to get down on that carnal level. But He said, well, you take care of them and grant unto your servants that with all boldness we do what? We speak the Word. That's it. Hallelujah. The boldness is so we can what? We can share the gospel. The boldness is so we won't be afraid to go into the communities, afraid to go down that street, afraid to go over to those particular people. Why? Because we have the confidence of God. We trust God that if God is leading me, if God is guiding me, if God is directing me, I am not to fear what man can do to me, because my whole objective is to do what? Is to share the message of Christ. That's what boldness is about. It's about communicate the message of Christ. And when you're talking to somebody one-on-one, you don't have to scream at them. You don't have to get up and think you got to preach to them and preach them up or preach them down. You talk with them, but you got to have confidence. You got to have courage. Yes, you can't be timid. You can't be passive. You can't go to them like you don't know your book. You got to go to them like you know this book and you believe what it has said. And you are sharing it with them and they'll be persuaded. They'll listen to you and they'll see your heart and they'll see your passion and they'll see your commitment to want people to know Christ and to know His love and to receive His forgiveness, your concern and your care for souls. They're going to read all of that in the conversation. That this person is not just, you know, out here trying to get me to just come to their church so they can get some attendees. They're out here because they're concerned about my soul. They're concerned about my eternal destiny. They want to share Christ with me. Well, it takes prayer to cause that to happen. Well, the last thing, the spiritual weapon of prayer provided the church the wisdom needed in order to respond to the growing changes in the church. If you look over in Acts chapter 6, verse 1 through 7, the Bible says, now in those days when the number of the disciples was multiplying, notice, they were multiplying. Hallelujah. They were being converted. They were repenting. They were turning away from the world and the love for the world to the love for God. There arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists because of their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. Then the 12 summoned the multitude of disciples and said, it is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve table. Therefore, brothers, seek out from among you seven men full of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith in the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, Nicanor. So they named all these particular names of people that they chose. Then in verse 6 says, and they set before the apostles, and when they had prayed, they laid hands on them. Then the word of God spread, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. Now, in any institution, be it spiritual or natural, wherever there is the assembling of people, there would be the potential for conflict. However, the early church did not allow church matters to remove or distract them from the spiritual weapon that was enabling the church to be effective in soul winning. They did not allow those matters, those ministry issues, to distract them from the priority of the church, and that is prayer in the spreading of the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, due to this increase of converts into the church community, selfishness entered, and spiritual equipped and spiritual minded men were needed to ensure peace in unity. Hallelujah. Glory to God. These were not just men that were attending church and people thought, oh man, you know, they come to church and we got to get them involved. These were men full of faith, full of wisdom, and full of the Holy Ghost. These were men who not only knew how to serve tables, but they knew how to go out and share Christ to others. Stephen, hallelujah, he didn't only serve tables. He went out and served the message of Christ. He preached Christ. Hallelujah. Boldly preached Christ, coming against traditional strongholds and bondages and proclaiming Jesus. Philip did the same thing. And sometimes people think, well, you know, these are the deacons in church. Well, you know, we use this as a model in when we're dealing with deacons, but these are just servants. These are servant leaders. And these are men that not only know how to do ministry, but they know how to carry out mission. And that's very important, because sometimes the church, all they want to think about is ministry, how we can take care of one another. And there's a dying world out there. But these men were filled with the wisdom of God, the Holy Spirit and Word of God. And they didn't only sit and work in ministry, doing things to care for the congregation of the assembly. They went out into the world and spread the message of Christ. Why? Because they were praying. Because the church was praying and the Word of God was priority. The delegating of responsibility was needed in order that the priority of the church would remain. And the priority of the church is seen in verse 4. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer in the ministry of the word. That is what? The spreading of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The spiritual weapon of prayer was not only effective in spreading of the gospel, but also in establishing servant leadership. The Bible say that these men, not only did they qualify because of their spiritual undergirding, hallelujah, full of faith, full of wisdom, full of the Holy Ghost, but what happened? They prayed, they laid their hands on them. They released that anointing on them. They released that anointing whereby these men were not out to just be business agents of the church. yeah. Men who wanted to take care of the business matters of the church. These were spiritual men. Oh, glory to God. These men cast out devils. These men proclaimed Christ. These men led people to salvation. They get this. They produced converts. Not church attendees. You know, sometimes people say, well, you know, that's a potential prospect. So what? So we can get them in the church. Man, I'm telling you right now, we got to get people born again and filled with the Holy Spirit, because there's a work that got to be done, and God need an army that's full of wisdom, full of the Holy Spirit, full of the Word of God, so we can go out there in that world. That world is anti-Christ. That world is against the things of God. That world does not love God. Satan is the god of this world. He's the prince of the air. He's the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. We see all this destructive stuff going on and people doing all this evil and killing and all this. People don't realize the devil is out there working through people. And people are listening to him. And people are yielding over to his suggestions and his ideas and his things he putting in their mind. Well, we're the body of Christ. We're yielding our members to the Lord Jesus Christ. We are being renewed in the spirit of our mind with the word of God. We're out there too, but we're not out there destroying. We're not out there doing evil. We're out there proclaiming the kingdom of God and the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Well, the early church is the model for the present day church, whose mission is centered around the spreading of the message concerning Jesus Christ and his saving grace in a hostile world that seeks to justify themselves and not receive the justification Jesus has provided for sinners. And that's the world that we're living in today. People are seeking to justify themselves, and they're seeking to justify sinful lifestyles. You know, saints, the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The thing about Christians is that our sins are atoned for, that the blood of Jesus cover our sins. Therefore, even though we're not perfect, flawless, we make mistakes, we miss the mark, but thank God that we have a Savior named Jesus whose blood have blotted out our sins. He has been sacrificed for our sins. He has made us righteous through his own blood. We're in his family. We're children of God. Hallelujah. We're not out here trying to compare ourselves to the world to see who's better. We just recognize that we are sinners and needed the saving grace of Jesus. And we trust Jesus. He is the only one that can forgive sins. He is the only one that can give eternal life. And he's done that for us. And get this, and we're glad about it. Hallelujah. And we should be. We should be bold about it. We should be bold, not arrogant, but we need to be bold about our faith. This is a precious salvation that we have. This is a precious gift that God has given us. We're not ashamed of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. Yes, we don't hide our faith. We don't allow the world to come and, you know, tell us, well, you know, I don't have religion. The world has religions. I have a righteousness that have come through my relationship through faith in Jesus Christ and what he did at Calvary in his resurrection. And now we begin to what? We begin to pray. We begin to spread the message of Christ with boldness. In Romans 5:1, the Bible said this, therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us. Listen, if you're born again, you got peace with God. God is not angry at you. The wrath of God is not going to come on your life. Hallelujah. The judgment of God is not going to come on your life. We're not going to stand before the Lord to be judged based on our sins. We're going to stand before the Lord to receive our rewards for our faithfulness. Hallelujah. Yes. And so when you recognize that it is through Christ that we've been just, we have peace with God. There are a lot of people don't have peace with God. And the only way you can have peace with God is through the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, the Holy Spirit power is waiting for the church to take her rightful place and exercise in the spiritual weapon of prayer in order that his convicting power will prick the heart of sinners and those who have wandered off the spiritual path like Peter did will turn around, be converted, and go and strengthen the faith of others that they too may turn around and follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So the bowing of the knees, the sincere posture in prioritizing a prayer with connects with God's work in the earth. I'm telling you, there is a movement, and there's only one movement, and that is the movement that God is doing. And we as believers, through prayer, we are connecting with the heart of God. We are connecting with where God is at work in the world, and we are praying so that we can stay sensitive to the heart and will of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is done through the exercise of the spiritual power of prayer in the daily life of the church in the spreading of the message of Christ. When we're in the church and we're praying, we should be praying for the spreading of the gospel. We should be praying for the harvesting of souls for the kingdom of God. Jesus said the fields are white, they are ripe, they are ready. He's looking for some people who will go into the harvest of the Lord and open their mouth with boldness. That's not arrogance. That's not screaming and thinking that loudness is power. Sometimes people think that when they pray, the louder I am, boy, that means power. No, It doesn't mean you have power. It means you got a big mouth, or you just like you come from a traditional practice where you saw that and you just mimic that, and you think in the church you got to pray loud, you got to scream. You know, there are times when the anointing come on you and you may speak with such authority and boldness, but you don't have to think every time you pray you got to scream in order, you know, like you got like the devil hard of hearing. Listen, the devil is a spirit. He's not hard of hearing. It's what he's hearing. If he's hearing the word of God and the person who's speaking that word have faith, boldness, confidence, and a commitment to that word, he will listen. He will obey. In the name of Jesus, demons will tremble. Another thing is exercising the spiritual weapon of prayers by praying for the boldness to speak God's word in a hostile world. You got to have confidence now. You can't be wondering, well, what if they curse me out? What? And they may curse you out. They may say, get out of my face. That's okay. They're not rejecting you. They're rejecting Jesus. But it's going to be on the record that God sent the word to them, but they rejected the word. And people are doing that today. They're rejecting the word of God. They're rejecting Christ. Listen. Jesus do not send people to hell. People choose to go to hell because they reject heaven. And Jesus has provided a heaven for those who will believe and trust in him. Another thing is exercising the spiritual weapon of prayer and using godly wisdom in addressing the needed changes within the church fellowship in order to fulfill the mission in the world. Saints, let me tell you something. You can brag about all your ministries in your church. I'm not praying for ministries in the church. We have some here, but I'm not praying. I'm praying for mission. How can we go out into that world and impact the world with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ? You know, the church shouldn't be talking about how many people we got attending. How many converts do we have in these gatherings? And converts are people who don't look for a church for preferences and pleasures. They look for a church so that they can be empowered and equipped so that they can go out there and communicate the gospel, the message of Christ to a dying world. That's the heart of a convert. Well, we're going to stop there. Thank you for joining me with the word of God and investing in your spiritual development in order to witness God's grace and glory in your own life. And I don't know about you, but anytime you're eating good food, you're going to make sure you're at that table to enjoy that meal. I'm just preaching the word of God. And sometimes, you know, when you identify with the reality of some of the traditional practices that's present in our day, they were there in Jesus' day. They were in the church. And when Jesus went to that church and, you know, he turned it upside down because they were, you know, turn it into a business center, and people are doing that today. You know, the priority is to create all of these business entities within the church and all this stuff. And you know, the church is simple. We need to keep it simple. It's about equipping people so that we can go out and we can spread the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the heartbeat of the church. And when we get focused on just ministries, all we're trying to do is you know, maintenance, take care of things and keep people happy so they won't leave and all this kind of stuff, you know, cause they get kind of fidgety. They want, I got to do something. It's a whole world out there that needs saving. It needs saving. They need to hear the gospel. And we need to be focused on what's the mission. The mission is not going to happen in here. The mission happens out there. And I believe that's the early church. The early church was on a mission. And the Bible says even when they were persecuted, they were scattered. And everybody that was scattered, what they did, they went into the mission field. They went everywhere sharing Christ. Didn't need a pulpit. Didn't need a license. Didn't need a title. Didn't need a robe. Didn't need a purple shirt with a collar. They just went and shared their faith in Christ, and lives were transformed for the glory of God. All those people, 3,000 souls coming into the church at that time, those were converts. Those were people who said, what must we do to be saved? Repent, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, be baptized in the name of Jesus, have your sins forgiven, get into the church, and then what? Start feasting on the doctrine, fellowship, breaking of bread, and prayers, connect to the church so you can be equipped and go out and do the work of the ministry. But I'm going to stop. I'm going to move on. Well, I want to thank the leaders for their faithfulness in communicating with me and those who were able to show up on yesterday during our leadership training. Training, as we know, is for transformation and not just information. And so let's be faithful and prayerful so that we can get the fruits, be fruitful, see the fruit of our training. Next Sunday is our Financial Discipleship Sunday, and I want to thank all Word Alive members for knowing the vision of your church and honoring God with the provision and doing so faithfully, because God is the one who's supplying your needs and beyond your needs. So you can what? So you can take care and minister in the vision of your local church and also in the lives of others for the glory of God. Well, God bless you. Continue to bow your knees. Take that sincere posture and keep prioritizing prayer so that you and I can tap into where God is already have his movement. He's already at work. He's doing something marvelous, and we're joining in through prayer. God bless you. Have a great day.